Praise the Lord, everybody. Welcome to Hope Community Church. It's good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. I wonder if we could lift up the name of the Lord. Lord, we're so thankful for your presence tonight. Lord, we're so thankful for what you're going to do. Lord, prepare our hearts for your word. God, we want to learn. That you can go to God in prayer. I am thankful that he has captured my heart. My dad preached a message one time. It was called Caught by the Heart. Amen. And he just explained how God apprehends us. Amen. I am thankful that although I have not apprehended that which, but he's apprehended me. Amen. I am thankful for the Lord this morning or tonight. Amen. We have talked about the power of daily prayer. Amen. There's power in prayer. You may be seated tonight. There's power in a consistent daily prayer life. Amen. How many can testify to that? And this is where we truly build our relationship with God. We don't do it in church. Amen. You can deepen your relationship with God in church. You can have amazing experiences with God in corporate worship. But if you don't have the backbone of a prayer life, then you will not have a relationship with God that has very much substance. Amen. Prayer is so important. Prayer invites God into your life. And I don't want a superficial or surface-level relationship with God where I only worship Him in front of other people. Amen. That's like having just a social media life, just what other people can see. That's my whole life. Amen. But I want my prayer life to be deep. I want Him to be my closest confidant. Amen. I want to go to God with all of my life's cares before I go to anyone else. Because He said to cast all of your cares upon Him. I was talking to somebody about that last night. You know, we think, when I was growing up, my mom would tell me, well, God doesn't care about your card game. So don't pray that you win the card game. And I have to challenge her on that. He said, cast all of your cares. And I care if I win the card game. Amen. I was talking to a friend about what Pastor has been talking about for the past few weeks, and we were discussing marriage. And it is very clear to us that people tend to put things upon their spouse that were meant for God. A connection. We all have a God-shaped hole in our hearts, in ourselves, if you will, and we are incomplete without Him. And if we're not careful, we will expect a significant other to fulfill what only God can fulfill in our lives. The truth is that longing that you have will only be filled through prayer and a relationship with God. That's not to say that we don't need our spouses. Pastor went very deep into that, how God gave us our spouses as a gift to us. And if you want to hear more on that, go and listen to our online recording of that. But getting back to the whole man, last week we talked about the head, the mind, the eyes, the nose, the ears, and the mouth. And we only really scratched the surface of the spiritual application of praying over the head. And I'm sure that you will understand that subject much more when God begins to reveal more to you as you practice it. Amen. And that's the beauty of prayer. Our flesh thinks that we're going to go in a room alone and we're just going to speak to the air and nothing is going to happen. But we know that God answers prayer. Amen. And He opens up doors that we didn't even know to knock on. And He leads and He gives direction. Amen. I was thinking yesterday about Psalms chapter 23, and it's such a beautiful passage. It's such a beautiful thing to pray, and I just want to go into a spirit of prayer right now on Psalms 23, and you can pray that chapter, and you can say, Lord, be a shepherd, Lord, to every saint in this church, God. You are the good shepherd, Lord. They will not lack anything. They won't want for anything because you are their provider, Lord, and you make us lie down in green pastures, and you lead us beside still waters, and there's peace in your presence, Lord. I'm so thankful for peace that passes on all understanding that only you can provide, Lord, and only you can restore my soul, Lord. And you lead us in the paths of righteousness for your name's sake. And I'm thankful this tonight that we are people of the name. And you show us how to be righteous for the sake of your name. And when we walk through valleys, we don't have to fear evil. We don't have to fear what's going on because you are with us, Lord. Amen. I'm thankful for the correction of your rod and the direction and comfort of your staff, Lord. Lord, you provide even when we are in the presence of enemies, your favor is there with us. Lord, anoint every head, God, anoint every man, woman, and child in this church. Fill every saint with your spirit, Lord. God, equip us for the work of your ministry, Jesus. Lord, let every cup run over. God, we want to minister in the overflow. We want to be full, and we want our cup to run over so that we can minister to others. God, and we know that your goodness and your mercy will follow us all the days of our life, and we will dwell in your house forever, Jesus. That's how easy it is to pray the scripture. And there's an application. I can't apply everything that I hear preached to my life. Everything that I hear preached, I can't apply it to my life. Some things that I read in his word, I don't have the ability to apply to my life. I have to ask him to apply it to my life. That's one thing we were talking about praying the scriptures, offering the scriptures back up to God. We sing this song. It came out in 2020 over COVID. It's called The Blessing. It's just the scripture that says, the Lord bless you and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious, all of that. And what's interesting I found in scripture about that prayer is that that prayer was given to Moses by God. God gave Moses this prayer, and he said, you pray this prayer over Israel. And so we have a precedence for giving the scriptures back to him. Praise God. And we're going to get into today's topic. We're talking about the shoulders, the heart, and the belly. Amen. The shoulders. Hebrews chapter 12, if you'll turn with me. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Amen. There's so much truth packed into just those two verses. Carrying weight often falls on our shoulders. Amen. So having strong shoulders is extremely important for many of our everyday tasks. The head sits on the shoulders. The arms are supported by the shoulders. The shoulders often carry a heavy load. And the Lord is asking us to lighten that load. Sin will weigh you down. The adage is that sin will take you farther than you want to go, and it'll keep you longer than you want to stay. And young men and women often find themselves having to learn this the hard way. In our flesh, we believe the lie of the enemy that says it's all going to go our way. I'm going to do this one thing, and I'll be able to control it. Amen. But sin will always take you farther than it advertised. The truth is that sin, lust, when it is conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, it brings forth death. The wages of sin is death. That's what you earn. When you sin, you've done the work of sin, and your payment is death. But the Bible doesn't just say to lay aside every sin. It also tells us to lay aside every weight. And this brings us to the conclusion that not everything that we carry is sin, but some of it is just dead weight. It isn't helping us through life. It's just a weight. And it isn't doing anything for us spiritually, but it's just a weight. There's nothing wrong with it, but except for the fact that it's weighing us down. And we are commanded to lay these things down as well. And Paul said, all things are lawful, but not all things are expedient. All things are lawful for me, but not all things edify me. You come to the conclusion when you take up all these responsibilities that there's only 24 hours in a day. And I've got to sleep for 8 of those. And so I've really just got 16 to work with. And I've got to spend time with family. And I've got to work. And how much time do I really have to do the work of ministry? And so you've got to lay things aside to make room for him. Just because you can do something, it doesn't mean that you should do something. There are some things that are just weights. We can't waste our time doing things that don't edify us. And our shoulders only have so much strength, and we need to carry the things that God has asked us to carry. I think it's interesting that these verses in Hebrews, right after he talks about laying aside weight, he talks about the cross of Christ. Right after he says, lay aside the sins and the weights, he brings up Jesus on the cross. And it says, when you have laid aside the weight and the sin, run the race that is set before you, and look unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of your faith, who was who was able to endure the cross because of the joy that was set before him. We have a joy that is set before us. We have to keep our eyes on the prize. Amen. Paul kept his eyes on the high calling, the prize of the high calling. And no matter how hard life gets, I'm going to keep running. I'm going to keep my eyes fixated on Jesus. Amen. And Jesus tells us in Luke chapter 9, verse 23, he says, and he said unto them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Nobody said it was going to be easy. The reason that you're laying aside every weight and sin is because there is something else. There's another burden that you have to carry. And we have to take our own cross and we have to follow Jesus. And he said, take your cross daily. Daily I have to climb the hill and I've got to crucify my own flesh. Daily I've got to take my desires up and I've got to crucify my desires. And I've got to go to God in prayer and I have to say, Lord, what is your plan for today? What would you have me to do? I've got my own desires. My heart's trying to lead me one way, Lord, but where do you want to lead me? I have to pray for wisdom to know the things that I need to carry. I want to know the things that I need to lay down. And I just said that no one said it was going to be easy, but Jesus kind of said it in a way. Matthew chapter 11, verses 29 through 30 says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find the rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Amen. When we're kids and we read the scripture and we see yolk, we immediately go to an egg and think, what does an egg yolk have to do? Yeah, they're pretty light. Amen. But a yolk is a device that they put on oxen, and it locks them together. And so two oxen can pull and it can plow a field much better. Three times actually is better as one can do. Amen. And they can now plow the field together. And Jesus is saying that if you will yoke yourself together with him, that it's easy. And to the man that has been yoked together with sin, it is easy being yoked with Jesus. Because that sin, you used to be yoked together with sin, and that sin would carry you wherever it wanted to. You didn't want to. You planned on stopping. You planned on not doing that anymore. But the sin, the yoke of sin, your lust carried you around. Amen. And I used to be trapped going wherever my lust took me, but now I'm free with Jesus, and he leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul, and he leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And his burden is light upon your shoulders. And while you're praying for your shoulders, you can pray prayers like, Lord, help me understand the things that I need to carry, Lord. Grant me wisdom and the strength that it takes to lay things down. God, I commit that I will daily take up my cross, Lord. I'm daily going to crucify the flesh and be a living sacrifice that is holy and set apart and acceptable to you. Lord, I want to take your yoke upon me. Lord, thank you for breaking the yoke of sin that was on my life. Amen. And then we come to the heart. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9 says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? And then verse 10 answers the question. It says, I, the Lord, search the heart. People like to just quote that. Who can know it? There's nobody that can know the heart. Well, the Lord knows your heart, and the Lord can search your heart. And he says, I search the heart, and I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doing. Amen. God is going to reward you whatever way you sow. Those that sow sin, they're going to reap death. And those that sow righteousness, they're going to get righteousness. Amen. And God knows the heart, but the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And that's why you should never trust anyone. Never trust anyone who is telling you to follow your heart. Amen. That's a great saying. That sounds really cool, but that's a bad idea. Amen. You will run into all types of trouble following your heart. Your heart can't be trusted. Your heart changes its mind day to day and moment to moment. Whatever you feel, And what I feel might have nothing to do with reality. And that's why we teach that love is not a feeling. Love is a choice. And I choose to love my wife. And if I don't feel the butterflies, that's just too bad. I made a commitment, and there are plenty of times with butterflies, but there's also hard times. There's times when I'm not leading how I should be leading. And then Genesis 3:16 is in effect. And there are times when I'm trying to rule over her and she's against me. But if I trust in my heart in those times, then I would be in a world of hurt. That's why divorce statistics keep climbing year over year, because people are trusting their hearts. Amen. Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 26 through 27 says, "A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them." Amen. It's such a blessing to be able to read these Old Testament scriptures in hindsight, to be able to say that we've already received the promise, but these people had to read this and they had to wait years. They never even saw it. Their children and the children of their children, their great, 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 great grandchildren saw it. But it's not all bad news. He said, there's coming a day when you won't have to rely on your heart, but I'm going to put my spirit in you and I'm going to give you a new heart and you're going to have the power to walk in my statutes. Jeremiah tells us that a day would come when he would put his law in our inward parts and he would write his law on our hearts. And so I saw a preacher say this and I thought, wow, that's so powerful. He said the Ten Commandments become the Ten Promises. He said, when God is done with you, you won't worship any other god. You won't be led around by your own lust. You won't have idols. You won't struggle with worshiping idols. And you won't take the Lord's name in vain anymore. And you will honor your father and mother. You won't kill. You won't commit adultery. You won't steal. You won't bear false witness. And you will be content when you have the Spirit of God that comes upon your life. You won't covet. Amen. And this is what Jesus can do with your heart. My heart is deceitful, but he is the Spirit of truth. And if I will follow his heart, the heart that he gives me, I'm going to be okay because his heart comes with his word written on it. And we see this time and time again. There's people that come in and God fills them with the Spirit and they start doing things without ever reading it in the word, just because the Spirit is leading them. Just because now they're yoked together with Jesus and he starts showing them things before they even open up the word. That's the power of prayer. And it's not going to only be something that I interact with outside of myself. It's going to be in me. It's going to be written on my inward parts. Psalms chapter 139, verses 23 through 24 says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." I don't want my heart to lead me. I want God to lead me. Amen. And when you pray over your heart, you can pray, "Lord, I know that in me, that is in my flesh, Lord, dwelleth no good thing. Lord, but your Spirit is there. In your Spirit, there is life. Lord, touch my heart, Jesus. My heart lies to me. I can't trust my own emotions sometimes, but Lord, I trust you. God, and I'm trusting that you will lead me with your Spirit. Lord, make me more sensitive to the direction and the desires that you put in my heart, Lord. God, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me." Amen. The belly. I've mentioned that the whole man does not cover all of that the Bible says on each subject. It really only scratches the surface of each, and you can dig out more for yourself. And I pray that you would discover more in your own study and in your own prayer life. But when I saw that the belly was one of the members that we were praying over, my mind immediately went to Philippians chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. It says, "Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk so, as ye have for us an example." So mark those that are good leaders, that are following Christ. It says, "For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things." And Paul is warning the Philippian church to watch out for who they look to as a leader, because there's certain people who have their mind on earthly things. They're just trying to get ahead, and they're trying to be leaders, but they are enemies of the cross of Christ. And if you follow them, they will lead you to destruction. And it says their God is their belly. They follow after whatever the appetite tells them. They follow after whatever their appetite tells them to follow after. And they're only seeking to consume. Amen. They're really only in it for their personal gain. And we have to be careful that us as individuals, that our God, our belly doesn't become our God. I don't want to be so gluttonous that I only seek to consume. I'm only in the church for what they can do. I just want to come and sit on a pew. I don't want to contribute to the worship. I just want them to pour into me. I just want the pastor to preach to me. I don't want to go up the mountain and talk to God. I just want the pastor to go and talk to God, and then he can tell me what God said. Because those people don't ever have to pray. Those people don't ever have to worry about a spiritual life. They can just come and they can hear what God said to the pastor. Amen. John chapter 7, verse 38 says, "He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water." And Jesus was referring to the Holy Ghost that had not yet been poured out. He said, from our inward parts, God is going to make life flow out of our inward parts. God is going to use the most unruly part of the body, the tongue. And God is going to replace a heart that is deceitful and wicked. And he's going to use a belly that all it does is consume. And these wicked members are going to bring forth rivers of living water. Things that are only meant to consume, things that are wicked, God is going to use them to produce. Amen. God has the power to transform your members through the Holy Ghost. And our natural bellies only consume. And when appetite is not controlled, our belly becomes our God. But when the Spirit of God is given to you, it will flow out of your belly. And you will not only consume, but you will pour out. And you will not take from those around you, but you will bless them. I don't want to be a vessel that only consumes. I don't want to show up just to hear the preaching, but I want to be used in the kingdom of God. And I want to pour out, and I want to bless others. And I want to be a vessel through which the love of God can flow. Amen. And when you're praying over your belly, you can pray prayers like, "Lord, your word says that if we believe in your word, out of our bellies will flow rivers of living water. I want to be a vessel that you can use, Lord, that you can flow through. Lord, let everything that is in me bless your holy name, Jesus. Lord, I pray that my spiritual hunger would be filled by your truth and your presence, Lord. Lord, you said, blessed are they which hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Lord, put a hunger in every one of us tonight, Lord, for righteousness. Lord, let us hunger and thirst after righteousness, God. I want to shun wickedness. I want to shun every evil thing, Lord. I want to only be focused on your righteousness, Lord. I want to be filled with you. I want less of me. I want to decrease, Lord, so that you can increase, Jesus. God, only you can satisfy the longing in my soul. Amen. Praise God. I hope that this lesson has blessed you tonight. We're going to go ahead and take up our offering. Why don't we pray over it together? Amen. Lord, we're so thankful for your presence tonight, God. We're so thankful for what you're doing, Lord. God, I ask you, Lord, to put a hunger in this church, Lord, for prayer. Put a hunger, Lord, for us to connect with you on a deeper level, Lord. I don't want a surface level relationship with you, God, but I want something deep, Lord. I want to dig out a prayer life. I want to dig new wells, Lord. I don't want to just rely on the prayers of elders, Lord, but I want to create something today for us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, bless this offering, Lord. Bless this church in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Lord.